human bones can hide the most shocking of secrets.
Oh my God, she's been killed.
She's been killed violently with a sword.
Stories of slaughter, sacrifice, and disease.
Success was built on the broken bodies of children like these.
Crimes covered up for hundreds or even thousands of years.
Somebody could have committed this murder and then jumped ship and never brought to justice.
I'm Dr. Tori Herridge, and I'm leading a team examining some of the UK's most mysterious archaeological burial sites.
There are so many unanswered questions. Let's cut to the chase. Is it a fertility ritual?
With bones as our only witnesses, mortuary technician Carla Valentine will help identify what happened to the bodies.
To me, this is the most fascinating find.
While archaeologist Raksha Dave gathers crucial evidence from key experts.
A line of small children's heads? That's absolutely bonkers.
Across the length and breadth of the UK, we'll reveal the way our forebears lived, loved and died.
What sort of hopes and dreams did she have in her head? What was she planning on doing with her life?
People long forgotten.
Makes you wonder
what brought her here. Until now. Caithness. Beyond the Scottish Highlands, this is the most northerly county of mainland Britain. Remote. Bleak. But just over 30 years ago, this was the site of an extraordinary archaeological discovery.
One cold February day, back in the winter of 1987, workmen were extracting rock from this ridge to make improvements to the nearby road. What they weren't expecting to find was a prehistoric grave cut into the rock. Inside were human remains, a single body laid to rest alone. So, who was this person buried here in this isolated spot, miles from anywhere?
See, this grave was found in Scotland, right?
Yeah, really far north, about 5.5 hours drive north of Edinburgh.
So, here.
Yeah, just shy of Wick. Oh. So it was right near to a village called Akavanik, which is here, just off the A9.
So if there's a major road there, the A9, I can imagine it's not that remote now.
No, loads of traffic passing by. The grave itself was situated on the side of a grassy ridge. You would never have guessed there was a prehistoric grave there. Maya, you were the driving force behind the re-examination of this burial, and this is a skeleton. Isn't a huge amount left.
No, you're right. There's not a huge amount of the skeleton remaining, but what we can see, so we have the cranium surviving, so this is the upper part of the skull. Then we have a number of the long bones, including the right arm, the legs from both sides, and a number of the vertebrae and ribs as well.
Why is there so little of it remaining?
Well, I mean, this burial was in the ground for a very long time, and throughout that time, natural processes of erosion have happened. What we think is that water has gotten into the kiss, this stone-lined grave, and you're starting to see things like mineralisation, so this sort of mottling of different colours appearing on the cranium. We think this is from deposits from the water that's sort of built up over time.
So you say a long time. What sort of time? What sort of time period?
Well, what we've done radiocarbon dating on this skeleton. And what the dates tell us is that this individual was alive around 2300 to 2145 BC. So we're looking at around 4,250 years ago.
That's sort of what early Bronze Age,
yeah,
just before?
Very beginning of the Bronze Age.
Very beginning of the Bronze Age. Oh, wow. Can you say whether it was male or female?
Absolutely. So, yeah, we can start to look at different characteristics on the body that sort of gives us an indication of sex.
You haven't got much pelvis.
You're right, absolutely. And the pelvis is usually the primary way of doing this. So what we can do is, first off, looking at all of the bones, they're quite gracile, they're quite petite, and this is sort of one of the first indicators that this might be a female. What we can also look at is the brow ridges. So if we look just here on the cranium, you can see that it's quite flat. And what we tend to find is that with females, it tends to be quite flat, and with men, the brow ridges tend to be a little bit more pronounced. It sort of gives us an indication that this is probably a female.
Do we have an idea of age?
Yeah, so there's a couple of different things we can look at for age. So the first thing that we can look at is here on her vertebrae. So this is the sacral vertebrae. This is it's part of what forges and becomes the sacrum. So this is the base bone at the back of bottom of your spine. And what we can see is that there's indications that these had started to forge together, to fuse together, but hadn't completed. So that process sort of starts between 16 and 18 years of age. So we think that she's probably somewhere between 18 and 22 as this is sort of starting to happen. And one of the other ways that we can tell about age is by looking at her teeth. So if we look here, Ava, her teeth are not that worn. So again, that gives us an indicator that she's quite young.
Ah, and you said Ava there. Is that's her name, is it?
Yeah, so this is derived from the place name. So she was found at a place called Akavanik, and the central three letters of the place name is Ava. So that's sort of where the nicknames come from.
So she's quite young. She's got a relatively healthy skeleton. Any signs of cause of death?
No, we have no indicators of cause of death, but we do have a couple of things that tell us a little bit about her, things that happened to her during her life. If we look at her teeth, she has something that we call enamel hypoplasia. And what this tells us is that early in life, so under the age of two, that she suffered some sort of deficiency or illness that's left this mark on the bones.
So this is these areas here?
Yeah, exactly.
So what I'm seeing when you put all this together is a very ordinary Bronze Age woman. She was physically active, she was otherwise healthy, she may have got a bit sick in childhood, but so far so normal.
Is there anything that kind of sets her apart from other ones? Anything extraordinary?
Absolutely. So it's the things that she's been buried with that make this extraordinary. The most extraordinary thing included in this burial is this beaker here.
It is extraordinary. We've been ignoring it steadfastly as we talked about Ava herself. But it's beautiful. It's exquisite. I mean, okay. Is it decorated the whole way around?
Yeah, so it's very heavily decorated. And these impressions have been made using a bone tooth comb.
It's not just the pots that are lumbered with the name Beaker, because I've heard of a prehistoric culture that's referred to often as the Beaker people, the Beaker folk. I'm guessing that means that Ava was one of these.
Absolutely. So she fits into this much wider tradition. And we see burials like this appearing not just in Scotland, but elsewhere in the United Kingdom and also in Ireland.
I don't know much about the Beaker people, but I do know that right now their story is in flux. There's so much new information coming to light. I would love to find out more about them.
So we know that burials with Beakers have been found all over Britain. Over 1,000 of them so far. Raksh is travelling to Aberdeen, where Marshall College has one of the best collections in the country. She's meeting Alison Sheridan, who is fascinated by this fashion for placing beakers in graves.
Alison, I'm quite curious, who are the Beaker people?
That's a great question. It was a term that was coined about 1902 to describe people who were found buried with these very, very distinctive, normally highly decorated pots, mostly singly in graves. What we're looking at is it's almost like the Sunday best part of their pottery repertoire. And it's very interesting that they chose to put into the grave their finest pots for consuming stuff. These would have been a tribute and an offering for the dead, and they would have contained something. You can just see here, there's a sort of little hint of a tide line, that dark stuff in the inside.
Oh, so there's that staining that's kind of like running all the way around inside the pot.
Yeah. So we think it relates to a belief that the dead were going on some kind of journey into the afterlife. And for that journey, they needed some kind of sustenance, so food or drink for the journey. And when the contents have been analysed, in some cases it's been probably mead, in some cases probably ale, but in a lot of cases they've found traces of milk.
So that's quite weird, because aren't they lactose intolerant at that time?
Yeah, they are. And so it would have meant that had they drunk straight milk, it would have been uncomfortable. You know, they could have done it, but they could easily have fermented milk. Yeah, and for all we know, they could have had, you know, alcoholic fermented milk, because I think we don't really like to think of the dead going off with a nice cup of milk, you know. We want it to be alcoholic milk.
So is this a British thing?
No. The actual tradition of making beaker pottery originated in Spain or Portugal around 2800 BC. It spread in various ways. One way would be that the people in Spain and Portugal were sailors, yeah? And so some of them will have sailed north to France, and they might have been trading. And then, of course, the other routes would have been over land, particularly along rivers. So it spread into Central Europe. It spread as far as North Africa. It was fantastically widely spread. In Britain, this is where you get a definite evidence that it is incomers coming in from the continent. And archaeologists and geneticists can argue the toss, and they are arguing, as to how many people were coming over. But whether we're talking about 5,000, 50,000 people, it's very difficult to be precise.
We may not be able to determine how many beaker people came to Britain, but they appear to have arrived in successive waves over hundreds of years. And they brought with them a whole new way of life, a new culture of burial and bereavement.
So 2800 BC, you see these beaker culture appearing in the Iberian Peninsula. Then 200 years later, it's spread right through to northern France, southeastern France.
And it's over in Germany and Netherlands here.
It's even reached Sicily and Sardinia.
And then 2500 BC, it's across the Channel and into England and Scotland. And of course, Ava was living right up here and buried there as well.
Yeah, in the wilds of Caithness. What would have brought people there?
So I guess today we think of this as being a really remote part of the country, but perhaps they viewed it differently then. And what brought them, I guess, is the landscape there. It looks really good for farming. And perhaps they thought this was somewhere that they could grow their crops and farm their animals.
So Ava was probably involved in farming then?
Well, we think from the evidence that we have from her bones, so we have this cattle scapular included in the burial, so we think that they would have been domesticating animals and farming them.
But this was put in with flesh on it, presumably then as meat rather than just the bone.
Yes, we think that this was like a shoulder of beef. This was included as a food offering. And we also have this evidence from her bones that shows that she was doing physical, active, manual labour. So if we look here, you can see this area of abrasion. Now, this is a node, and what we can tell from it is that she was very physically active. We think that she was undertaking manual labour during life.
So this is due to the discs in the spine then, isn't it? So you've got your vertebral bone, you've got cartilage discs on either side, sandwiched, and then that disc is sort of herniated into the bone. It's kind of driven a little depression into it, hasn't it?
Exactly.
Is there anything else you can tell us about her?
What we've done is, so we've looked at her DNA. And what we can tell from her DNA is that whilst she is local to the area, she's not descended from the Neolithic population that were living there before her. She is entirely descended from people that were living on the continent. And we think that both her mother and her father's side have moved into Caithness from somewhere like the Netherlands at some point in the generations before her.
So they were living here in the Netherlands, and then they've gone right over and ended up in Scotland here.
Exactly.
Yeah, and then Ava herself, buried in Caithness. In Caithness, yes, okay, maybe it wasn't remote in part of that ancient prehistoric world, but her particular grave, that was in a really remote spot. There must be something about that spot, why they chose that spot to bury Ava there, that could tell us something more about Ava herself and her community.
Maya and I have travelled to the far north of Scotland, to the site where Ava was discovered in Akavanik, buried in a stone-lined grave called a kist.
Everything's been absolutely, completely taken away, so you can see this sort of scoop in the landscape. If we head just over here, I should be able to show you how I managed to figure this out.
Out of the 1,000 or more known beaker burials in Britain, only half a dozen of these kists have been cut into bedrock. This burial and this location must surely be significant.
Okay. Just here, you can see that fence post just there. And then in the background, you can see the pylon just behind it.
Yes.
So I think that's the burial just there. So it should be around about here.
So down here?
Yeah, exactly.
About here?
A little bit higher up.
here?
Yeah, just about there. So your head right now is roughly where Ava's head would have been.
Really? Say cheese. Oh my goodness. Is that how it was found?
Yes, this is what it would look like when the archaeologist came to excavate it. So she's lying on her right-hand side, her head is in the west, and she's facing south-southeast. Now, if we look at other Beaker burials from this time period, what we see is that women are buried in this way, but men tend to be buried lying on their left-hand side with their head in the east and facing south-southwest. So she's definitely part of this much larger burial tradition that we're seeing all over the country.
I mean, that's just it, isn't the first step in the whole process is to dig into this.
Absolutely.
Soil bedrock. And that's no small job with a deer antler. That's could have taken the best part of, I don't know, how long? How long would you think?
I'd say probably taken at least a couple of people a few days to do this.
Yeah.
So it really gives you a sort of idea of the, almost the strength of the community and how important it was to bury this individual in this way.
In this way, exactly. In this place. Mm-hmm. So they cared about her, they cared about the position enough to put that effort into doing it.
So if we look around us in the landscape here, there are lots of other prehistoric monuments. In fact, just about 2 kilometres in that direction, you have the Akavanic stone setting, which is a horseshoe shape, and it's made up of 42 standing stones. So this is a ritual landscape.
Obviously, the hills must have been here in Ava's time, but was this area the same? Did it look the same as it does today?
Well, what we've done is we've done pollen residue analysis on the beaker, and what we found is actually there's evidence that trees were in the landscape at this time, so it would have looked very different to what it looks like today.
It always, always amazes me that pollen can survive for so long.
Absolutely, and we don't just have the pollen surviving from the trees and the environment, we also have pollen surviving that we think might give us hints and clues about things that may have been included in the burial. So we know that there is evidence for flowers have been included in the burial, such as meadowsweet and St. John's wort. But what's even more interesting about these specific plants is that they have medicinal properties. So meadowsweet, we know, acts as a painkiller, so much like aspirin that we use today. And St. John's wort is used as a disinfectant. We know it was used up until the end of the Second World War for staunching wounds. So perhaps that gives us an idea of what was happening here and maybe what was the cause of death for Ava.
Do you think maybe the inclusion of medicinal herbs is an indication that maybe she was ill?
Yeah, so the St. John's wort particularly interests me, this concept of staunching wounds. And I think, as you say, she's very young, and this is a sort of prime age, I think, for bearing children. So perhaps we're looking at a case where a child has tried to be born and something's gone wrong, and for some reason the mother has died. I mean, there's speculation, but perhaps that's what's caused her death.
Visiting the site of Ava's grave, it really put things into perspective. I mean, it's not there now, but she's buried in one of these kists, which is typical of that period. And that kist was actually dug into the bedrock.
That must have taken a lot of work.
Yeah, days, Maya says. Now, there's no cause of death, but her age, the time in which she died, was an unusual age to die at for a woman, except that risky process of childbirth. And that's one of the things that Maya has put forward as an idea, is what may have killed her. Of course, we don't know. What we do know, though, is that she was buried in this really remote spot. And when you see the landscape, you realise how important the placement of that grave might have been.
Scattered about Akavanik are ritual sites dating back to the Neolithic people, who thrive throughout Britain from around 4000 BC to 2500 BC. We have comparatively few Neolithic burials. There are a handful here, but they tended to cremate their dead or leave their corpses exposed to the elements. By contrast, the Beaker people are usually buried. And because of this area's ritual significance, it didn't surprise archaeologists when they found other Beaker remains.
So this is a cranium of another Beaker burial. This one belongs to a man. So what we can see is that this gentleman has very pronounced brow ridges, which is very different to what we see in Ava. So we know that this is a male. And he's also been buried in Caithness.
Whereabouts?
So a place called Akaroll, and it's about 6 miles to the northeast of where Ava was buried.
So that's quite near then. I mean, were they buried the same way?
Very similarly, yeah. So he's also been buried in a kist, this stone-lined grave, but rather than being placed into a rock-cut pit like Ava was, he was buried into gravelly soil.
Were they part of the same community?
We think so. I mean, he was also buried with the beaker. And we've just done the isotope analysis. And what we see is it's very likely that he also grew up locally in the Caithness area.
Is there anything else, though, that can link them together?
Yes, so as you've probably noticed, they both have very round, very broad skull shapes. And this is something that's very common amongst beaker people.
To me, they actually look like mushroom tops. You know, a very round, very smooth surface.
We say that's a beaker feature. That implies there's differences for people who aren't beaker people.
Very much so. So what we can do is we can compare this to a Neolithic skull from somebody who is living in Neolithic Orkney. That's what we have over here. And what you can see is that the skull shape is much longer and narrower. Very different to what we're seeing with our beaker people.
Gosh, there really is a huge difference, isn't there?
Absolutely. And if we have a look over here, so if we look at this skull, so this one on the left is another Neolithic skull, but this time from Caithness, and we can see that the difference in the skull is, again, really drastically different to what we're seeing with the beaker skull, the one from Achill on the left-hand side here.
So three people from the same area who look quite different. And what you're actually saying there is that it's not just a new culture that has turned up, but the people who are bringing the beakers and the, you know, the beaker culture with them actually look different to the people who were already there. So our Neolithic person would have recognised and seen a different group of people. They would have said, you look different to me, you come from elsewhere.
Exactly. So there would have been a physical difference that they would have been visible to each of the communities. And what we start to see is this decline and disappearance of the Neolithic people from the archaeological record.
So you're saying that once the beaker people arrive, so, you know, Ava and Achill Man's community, once they arrive, the Neolithic peoples disappear?
Exactly.
Ava, then, was part of a community that seems to have taken over the country. Her beak of Macavanic is typical of their culture. Can examining how it was made tell us anything about its origins, or even about Ava?
Claire, these beakers, they're a particular area of your expertise, especially the ones that are found in Scotland. So what have you found out so far?
Well, I've been looking specifically at links between Scotland and the Netherlands in this period, and particularly looking at beakers that are found in graves in Scotland and graves in the Netherlands. As part of my research, I've been trying to unpack not just how the motifs that are on the beakers, which people have said there are links between the two areas because of the motifs and the shape, the form of the beaker, but also I've been looking in particular at how the beakers are made. And what I've found is the early beakers in the Netherlands do resemble quite a lot of these aspects in Scotland as well.
So are you saying that these people are bringing those materials over to Britain, up to Scotland, so they're not using local material?
No, they are made of local clay. What I'm saying is the technology possibly is coming over from the Netherlands.
The Achavanic beaker is really quite a chunky beaker. It's been decorated when the beaker's quite wet. Often, if you want in a much more refined decoration, you'll wait until the beaker's dried a little bit to give you a little firmer surface to work into. This has been decorated quite quickly, and I sort of wonder if it hasn't been done in a hurry.
So when you say in a hurry, do you think it's because Ava died unexpectedly and they needed to make a beaker, or...?
I don't know, but there are a couple of factors about it. The first is that it's been decorated when it's wet. It's relatively crudely made, which sort of suggests it's possibly been done in a hurry. The decoration, as I say, applied when the pot's quite wet, which is a bit tricky because, as you can see, what you get is you get quite a lot of movement in the pot while you're trying to apply that decoration. Do you want to go at this?
I do, actually.
Off you go.
Right, I'm just going to continue with this line.
I'll continue this
and
line.
Now,
and
you feel, hopefully...
You
feel gosh!
But it's quite tricky
heavy,
now,
isn't it?
And it's heavy, and it's sort of difficult to control in the wet, as wet as it is.
Do you know what? It's quite funny, because there's like a few thumbprints in here, and sometimes you do get the occasional thumbprint,
don't you? Yeah, nail prints.
Yeah, and now I know why.
But I always find that fascinating, when you can find a mark in the surface of a pot. It's a frozen moment in time, or a baked moment in time, I suppose, in the case of pottery.
So is this process exactly the way it would have been done on the continent, Claire?
Ooh.
That deep boomph that you heard while you were talking there, that was probably the beaker spalling. In other words, a section of the beaker being blown off by too rapid a heating and steam forming within the beaker and it blowing apart. The reason why I think that maybe the beaker that was made for Ava was made in a hurry, the fact that it was spalled suggests that they were perhaps making it and firing it in a hurry to get it ready for the burial.
And I think the fact that it's used even though it's been spalled is interesting because that means it doesn't necessarily have to be perfect. You know, it's what the pot represents itself that's important.
So reconstructing Ava's beaker has shown us that the original was probably made very quickly, perhaps because, as Maya suggested, Ava died unexpectedly in childbirth.
It does make me wonder, you know, it's one thing to reconstruct a pot or a beaker like this, but it's quite another to reconstruct a person. You know, can we reconstruct Ava? Can we see what she looks like?
In fact, we can, and this is something that we did. So we decided to do a facial reconstruction to try and imagine what Ava would have looked like. And this is what we came up with.
Oh, like immediately you can see, can't you? It really brings to life that slightly crooked nose that's visible on the skull and the round face and short skull.
Except that this facial reconstruction is in fact wrong. And we can say this because of the ancient DNA work that we've done. So this is actually what we think Ava looked like.
Oh, gosh. So the same face shape, it's that same basic skeleton, to use the phrase, but just different decoration.
Yes, so what we see is that she would have had black hair, brown eyes, and slightly tanned skin.
You see, this interests me because there's a process in forensic science called DNA phenotyping. It's quite experimental, but the idea is that you can retrieve DNA from a crime scene and reconstruct somebody from that. So I'm assuming this must be the same sort of process.
Absolutely, it's a very similar process.
See, what interests me is something different. It interests me that, you know, when you've got the DNA evidence, you're able to challenge our assumptions. Now, that first reconstruction, how did you choose the colouring?
So what we did was we looked at what the local population was in Caithness at the moment. So we're inspired by that traditional red hair and blue eyes of the Scottish population.
Yeah, not too dissimilar to the way you look, Maya. Exactly, and that's just it. It's a perfectly logical assumption. Or is it? You know, Ava lived 4,000 years ago. Why do we assume that there'd be that connection right the way through to the present day? And the DNA, it cuts through that. It says, OK, you may assume this, but you are wrong. This is what Ava looks like. Quite different to what we might have expected.
I suppose what's interesting to think is that this is the face of the people that were coming in. This would have been a new face for them to look at.
Yeah, and to understand that, you have to put it in the context of what local Neolithic populations look like themselves. And the DNA work that's been done on some of those people has shown that, you know, British people in the Neolithic had dark skin and blue eyes. And then you see with the beaker folk, with people like Ava arriving, darker hair, dark eyes, but actually fairer skin. But then what happened after that? I mean, do they live together quite happily? Or why did all the Neolithic people, with their blue eyes and their slightly darker skin, why did they seem to disappear?
When we started our investigation, it seemed like Ava had been buried in an isolated spot, unconnected to any community. But now we think the Beaker people understood the sacred history of remote regions and chose to bury their dead in the company of Neolithic ancestors. But did Ava's people come here to share this land or to take it?
So what do we have here?
So again, we have another Beaker burial, and this is a male. We think this is an individual who is an elderly man, and he's been buried with another beaker that we can see here.
Can you compare the two beakers? This one has a more pronounced curve to it, a sort of wider top, maybe, a narrower base, certainly, relatively speaking. So do we have any radiocarbon results that can sort of correlate those dates?
Absolutely. So for this individual, has been dated to around 2290 to 2040 BC. So that's roughly 100 years after Ava. So we have some other artefacts included in this burial that are particularly interesting, and that's these wrist guards that you can see here. And they would have been worn like this by an archer.
So the wrist guards are usually on the arm to protect from the bowstring. But I imagine these must be ceremonial, because wrist guards are normally leather. There's no give in those.
And you think that they would have caught the string as it came back as well, exactly. Yeah, we think that these are to show off wealth and status and to show people, look at me, I'm important, I have these really unique objects.
Can I have a little look?
Yeah, please
do. It's a beautiful, beautiful stone. I mean, you can see why it's a, why it would be considered to be a special object.
And it's actually a really important type of stone there. So this is called Langdale Tuff, and it's found in the Lake District.
So Beaker people in Aberdeenshire were going all the way to the Lake District to get stone to make artefacts to bury their dead with.
Potentially they were going there, or potentially there's also some sort of suggestion of long-distance trade. But they weren't the first people to go and target this specific stone. We actually have evidence that suggests that Neolithic people also valued this very specific resource.
But the thing is, this archery aspect of the burial, it just seems like it's quite important. You know, this sort of representation of a warrior. You know, did they come over across the Channel to the British Isles to conquer?
We already know that the connections between the Beaker people in Scotland and those in the Netherlands were particularly strong. Can the sources there shed light on the archery artefacts and how the Beaker idea spread all over Europe? Is it possible that the Beaker people were, in effect, an invasion force? Raksh has flown to Holland to meet archaeologist Carsten Ventink in the National Museum of Antiquities in Leiden.
What an absolutely stunning group of objects. They are absolutely beautiful. What is this? What's that?
Well, this is a wrist guard or an arm guard. So they would have been worn by archers. But it's interesting because throughout prehistory, people have been working and shooting arrows. But never were they in the need of making these things out of stone. But in bigger times, suddenly they have this urge of making them out of fancy stones. And sometimes in some of the British examples, for example, are even decorated with gold. So it's really about display. It's about showing a particular identity.
So what's the significance of this?
Well, if we take a short excursion to the Alps, about 30 years ago, a body was found there, frozen in a gletsier.
Oh, you mean Ötzi?
Yes, exactly. He was a traveler crossing the Alps, and he was injured, died, and he was frozen in situ along with all his possessions. And the interesting thing is what he took on his journey, because he took a bow, a quiver, arrows, flint tools, a dagger, a fire-making kit, containers to contain food. Basically, if you look at it, all the different things we find in these Beaker graves. So, in my opinion, they are not portrayed as warriors or archers, but actually they are equipped and dressed as travelers going on this last final journey into the afterlife, perhaps.
The thing that I get from these Beaker people is this sense of wanderlust, that they want to go and travel. It's kind of packed in their DNA, almost.
Yes, traveling seems to be the thing. We have to remember that this is the time when we see the mass adoption of things like wheeled carts and horseback riding, and this coincides with the opening up of the Neolithic landscape that was densely forested but is now giving way to extensive heatlands and grasslands. So in a way, these are becoming the intercontinental highways, as it were, of Europe.
So with their thirst for travel, the Beaker people came to the British Isles. What kind of impact did their arrival have? Did they transform the country, or was it something much more superficial?
It's superficial in the sense that it's easily adoptable, but it has large repercussions because it opens up people to a huge network that spreads all across Europe. And that's why we find these identical styled objects from Malta to Scotland and from Poland to Portugal, basically. So all of Europe is tying in on this. And so it's actually part of the creation of this really large social network, as it were, which is used to exchange all sorts of objects and ideas and knowledge and people, so not superficial at all.
That's exactly the question, isn't it? I mean, the Beaker culture arrives and suddenly it appears to dominate. Did it take over the Neolithic culture? Did they effectively occupy, or is this story more about integration?
Well, Carsten made beaker culture sound very appealing and peaceful.
Yeah, yeah, and if it was peaceful, then, you know, maybe Ava may have had local friends. Just because her DNA doesn't suggest local ancestry doesn't mean she didn't know her Neolithic neighbours.
Exactly, I mean, maybe they had kids.
So, if the beaker fashion spread like wildfire and captured imaginations throughout the British Isles, what happened to the local Neolithic people? Back in London, Rax is visiting the Francis Crick Institute, specialists in biomedical research. Tom Booth has looked at the people living in Britain a few generations after the beaker people arrived, including Ava.
So how involved were you in sampling Ava's DNA?
So I was quite intimately involved with sampling Ava in that I drilled into her skull to remove bone powder, which is what we then extract DNA from. And we sampled her as part of a much larger project looking at the genetics of people who lived in Britain through prehistory.
So how accurate is the process and what do you do?
So it's pretty accurate. The techniques that have been developed over the last 10 years have essentially means that we can look at ancient DNA in similar ways in which we look at modern human DNA. What has also facilitated this is the recognition that a particular bone in the human body preserves DNA incredibly well, so we get a very rich, complex series of data from this particular bone.
And is that what we've got on this screen then?
This is a picture here. So this is what's called the petrous portion of the temporal bone.
And where is that?
So the temporal bone is a bone on the side of your head, around your ear canal. And the petrous portion is actually inside your skull. So as your ear canal travels into your skull, the petrous portion sort of surrounds it, forming this sort of pyramidal shape. Most bones in your body sort of change microstructural level in response to stress, or sort of adapt to your physical activity during life. And what that introduces is more porosity, so more little holes. But the petrous bone forms when you're in the womb, and then essentially it stays the same. So it doesn't remodel, so it doesn't have all these little holes in it, which means that no contaminants, no bacteria, no sort of chemicals can get in and degrade the bone so much as with the other bones.
So going then, what about Ava's results? What did you find out about her genetic signatures?
Ava actually has no detectable ancestry from the people who were living in Britain sort of 100 years earlier. And it comes from a time when we see a big shift in the genetic signature of people living in Britain. You get the British Neolithic ancestry, which is this green ancestry that you see here all the way through up until around 2450 BC. And then this sort of continental ancestry represented by the orange, you get around a 90% shift in the ancestry of people.
Gosh, that
living
much?
In Britain. Yeah, so this looks like quite a dramatic and sudden event initially.
Well, it does, because like it's completely green, the British Neolithic, and then all of a sudden it goes very orange, doesn't it?
It suggests that it's more this period of integration with people constantly moving in and out of Britain and sort of diluting the local signature.
Of that genetic data, you know, 92% beaker genes.
I know, it's pretty spectacular, isn't it? It's kind of almost like a beaker takeover of Britain. But you know, the interesting thing that Carsten said was he doesn't think it's violent. It's not a violent takeover. They didn't just come here and like decimate the whole population. So what's happening? You know, it's quite odd.
It is odd, isn't it? I mean, yes, okay, it's not instantaneous. It's over, a couple of hundred years? So that's generations, there's time there for things to change, but something clearly did change. And I'm just, trying to get my head around what that might have been.
I mean, there must be lots of contributing factors, Are we looking at a natural disaster? Some kind of famine? Are there, is there disease? Maybe they brought in disease from the continent, who knows?
Yeah, well, is it just a numbers game? I mean, there's got to be an explanation as to why, you see a turnover, really, in the genetic signal of the British population at that time. Maybe there just were a lot more beaker people. Maybe there weren't many people living in Neolithic Britain. And so you've just literally got a numbers game. It's just the starting of a new mystery.
We're investigating 4,000-year-old early Bronze Age burials in the far north of Scotland. They provide evidence of the arrival of the so-called Beaker people, who appear to have displaced the indigenous Neolithic population. The question is, how?
We've got three Beaker people all buried in Scotland. There's Ava, our 18 to 22-year-old woman, the man from Akerol, buried just a few miles away from Ava, and then don't forget our Aberdonian archer. But were they all born? Did they all grow up in Scotland?
Well, we know Ava did.
And it looks like we have the same evidence for the Akerol individual as well.
Yeah, and then coming back to Ava's ancestry, now she has this European ancestry, and that ties in with this bigger picture of the Beaker people in Britain. You see, by a few hundred years after the first Beakers arrive in the country, you see this genetic signature, which is 92%.
So don't forget the 8% that's contributed from the Neolithic population. That's really important to remember.
So what happened?
We're actually just catching up with archaeologist Ian Armitt at the Standing Stones of Duddo near Berwick in Northumberland. The stones date to the late Neolithic era, the time when the Beaker people arrive. Don't they suggest that the Neolithic people were thriving?
Quite impressive really, isn't it? Because you walk along these fields and they're quite flat, and then all of a sudden this mound just appears and there's these stones on the top. Well, why were people building these in the Neolithic?
Well, it's easy to think, I suppose, that these sort of fairly spectacular monuments are signs of some kind of really successful society celebrating its success. But actually, the stone circles are mainly being built at a period when we think Neolithic society is probably under quite a bit of stress and populations are potentially, you know, declining. So another way of looking at them really is, I mean, these are monuments, religious monuments, monuments to the gods. So one way of thinking about them really is that they are signs of a society that's increasingly desperate and increasingly putting its energies into making appeals to the gods to, you know, solve their problems and help them out. There's a whole series of strands of evidence that combine to suggest that by the late Neolithic, there was an agricultural decline that was causing stress for communities in Britain. So we can see that, for example, at the national level, when we look at, you know, pollen grains and peat bogs, for example, we can see that forest was regenerating, trees were growing over areas that had previously been farmed, suggesting that populations were declining. We find less and less evidence for cereal crops on sites across the UK. And even at the local level, so there was a site that I was excavating in the Hebrides, where we see a successful early Neolithic community who are establishing farming there. But over time, they're getting rid of the trees around that landscape, they're burning them for fuel. Soil is eroding down into the loch where they're getting their water from. And then as the trees run out, they resort to burning turf for fuel. And again, that strips the surface of the soil, which erodes into the loch. And it's a vicious cycle, really, of agricultural decline and soil depletion. And over time, that has a huge impact on the health and the well-being of those communities.
So it's a society in crisis, and then the Beaker people appear, and they kind of almost take over, don't they? I know that the disappearance of the Neolithic people is gradual, but where do they go? What happens to them?
That's a really important question. I mean, what we do know is that effectively, genetically, the Neolithic people effectively disappear, but they don't disappear completely in the sense that, you know, everyone after a few hundred years has a certain amount of Neolithic DNA within them, around about 10% or so. So there's different ways of looking at that. And one possibility is it's simply that the relative numbers of people coming in are such that they're genetically kind of swamping the indigenous population and absorbing them and creating a hybrid population that is a mixture of both. That's probably more likely than the other explanation, which would be some kind of great conflict and series of wars or massacres or whatever, because archaeologically we don't find any evidence for that kind of thing. What happens is over a few hundred years, we get to a point that, let's say by 2000 BC, pretty much anyone who's living in the British Isles at that point has got about 90% of their ancestry coming in from the continent and about 10% from those Neolithic populations. So these populations merge over time.
I suppose it does come down to numbers in a way. A huge sample of people, huge numbers of people have been tested. And from that, it seems to be saying, you know, that the Beaker people arrived in, you know, substantial numbers and they stayed and their genes stayed. And the story of the Neolithic people is one of waning and maybe disappearing from a genetic point of view. But that's just statistics. And it's great to talk about these things in broad general terms, but this is Ava, you know, the 20-something-year-old Beaker woman.
Absolutely. I mean, we know she was farming. We know she died young, possibly from childbirth.
And that's an interesting point to come back to, talking about possible death caused by childbirth. And there's no evidence in the burial of the child, so it makes you start to wonder, what if that child survived? And what if perhaps there are descendants of that child and of Ava living in Caithness today?
In some ways, to me, yeah, that could be true, but actually, that's not the biggest, most important or powerful thing about her story. To me, what's powerful about Ava is that she exemplifies the entire story of the Beaker people. She's one woman, yet from her story, we see this movement of people. She is a second generation, maybe third generation immigrant to the Caithness area. So she tells that Beaker tale, but she also tells a different story. Her personal story is tied directly to the land. Her people, her community cared so much about her and so much about the place that they lived in, they buried her in this kist, and that kist was actually dug into the bedrock. So on one hand, yes, she's Ava of the Beaker people, but on the other, she is Ava of Caithness.
Bone Detectives, back same time next week. Now, back on the night shift this Monday at 9, a decline on the high street equals an upsurge in calls. All new 999, what's your emergency? Next, born a free man and kidnapped into slavery. Part of Black History Month, Chiotel Ejiofor, and Michael Fassbender star in 12 Years a Slave.
Caithness. Beyond the Scottish Highlands, this is the most northerly county of mainland Britain. Remote. Bleak. But just over 30 years ago, this was the site of an extraordinary archaeological discovery.
One cold February day, back in the winter of 1987, workmen were extracting rock from this ridge to make improvements to the nearby road. What they weren't expecting to find was a prehistoric grave cut into the rock. Inside were human remains, a single body laid to rest alone. So, who was this person buried here in this isolated spot, miles from anywhere?
See, this grave was found in Scotland, right?
Yeah, really far north, about 5.5 hours drive north of Edinburgh.
So, here.
Yeah, just shy of Wick. Ah. So it was right near to a village called Akavanik, which is here, just off the A9.
So if there's a major road there, the A9, I can imagine it's not that remote now.
No, loads of traffic passing by. The grave itself was situated on the side of a grassy ridge. You would never have guessed,